Hello and welcome, or welcome back to the channel. Today we're going to do a little bit of a lightly scientific deep dive into aquarium lighting. So lighting is one of the most critical aspects of a successful aquascape, and it affects plant growth, coloration, algae development, and even fish behaviour. It's also one of the most misunderstood topics in the hobby, and today we're going to break it down from the science behind it to the practical steps that you can apply to your own tank. So why does light matter? Well, plants rely on light to perform photosynthesis, which is where they convert carbon dioxide and nutrients into energy. And without enough light, plants can become weak, pale, or stop growing entirely. But too much light without the right nutrients or CO2, well, that's how algae starts to take over. So understanding light isn't just about things being brighter and better. It's all about balance in the aquarium, and light plays a key part of that. Think of light as fuel. Too little and the plants will starve, and too much, then you might start to find that algae starts to take over. So when you purchase an aquarium light, you'll see a lot of things like lumens and wattage, and you might also see µmol, which looks like it's spelt like µmol. So I'm just going to say that because it's easier. Well, µmol sounds funny. But when you see that in aquascaping, and especially in lights for planted aquariums, the µmol is most commonly used when measuring light intensity. So a µmol per square meter per second basically means how many µmol of photons are hitting one square meter per second. Now, you might be like me, and that might mean absolutely nothing to you. And to be honest, I barely understand it as it is, but it's kind of easy if you know what numbers you should be aiming for, then you don't really need to know the deep science behind it. But basically, this measurement will tell you how usable that light is to a plant. And this matters for plants because plants don't see brightness or lumens or wattage the way that we maybe perceive it. They respond to how many photons they get. So a µmol per square meter per second measures exactly that. So some fairly typical values in aquascaping, at least this is what I found, but you might perhaps have a different suggestion, and I'd love to hear that. But typically in a low light tank, you would aim for 20 to 40 µmol. For medium, you would aim for 40 to 80. And for high light tanks, you would maybe go 85 plus all the way to 150, depending on the intensity and the strength of your light. Now, keep in mind that light intensity decreases exponentially with the depth of a tank. So let's just say a 60 centimeter tank in terms of depth gets way less light at the bottom of the tank than it does at the top. And that's why tank depth, plant density, and light height matter. So you can use a PAR meter if possible. You can download an app on your phone, and it can take the guesswork out of lighting and obviously help prevent algae or weak plant growth and just sort of get optimal levels in your tank. Now, that's obviously a very scientific approach to it, and it's sort of like getting really into the nitty-gritty. For me personally, that really starts taking the fun out of aquascaping a little bit. But credit to people who sort of like do go to those lengths and depths of trying to get like the perfect amount of light at the bottom of the tank. That is obviously extremely important, because if you're planting a carpet implant such as Glossostigma or Elatine Hydropiper, which are sort of the more difficult carpet implants to grow, or HC Cuba, then you really do need to make sure that there is enough light hitting the bottom of the substrate, because let's say on this aquarium, this is 45 centimeters deep, the light is all the way up there, so it's got to hit this sort of like bottom sort of 5 to 10 centimeters of the tank. Now, I can see that some of my hair grass in this tank has started to turn a little bit yellow. I have recently changed the light, so I am still sort of figuring things out a little bit. I also know that there is potentially a bit of a nutrient deficiency. It's quite an old tank. The soil's quite exhausted, but definitely light would play a part in that as well. So whilst it is sort of a little bit really getting into it with a par meter and things like that, it is something that you can do if you really want to try and get optimal growth in your tank. With that said, for the most part, a lot of the high-end lights, whether we're talking ADA, which is obviously extremely high-end, or Skylight or Chihiros or Twin Star, the sort of well-known high-end brands in the aquascaping world, for the most part, will probably provide enough lighting and be able to sort of be intense enough at a good height in order to provide plants, especially on the lower sort of levels of the aquarium, with enough light. But light isn't just about intensity, it's also about colour, and plants mainly use blue and red for growth, but they do also use green as well for photosynthesis. But full spectrum lighting, obviously including some green, is very important to make plants look natural, look vibrant, and obviously do good photosynthesis. And a balanced spectrum also helps your eyes perceive depth and contrast, making your aquascape look more sort of like alive and realistic, even though it already is realistic. But yeah, it definitely sort of helps with the wow factor of the aquarium. So your photoperiod is another really important thing. How long you leave your lights on is just as important as how bright they are. Now, most planted tanks do best, I would say, with a 7 to 8 hours of light per day. Some people manage to run them longer, which if your plant can take it, that's great. If you're starting a new tank, you should probably begin with a shorter photo period of about 4 to 5 hours and gradually increase it. And consistency is key. So using a timer to ensure that it's the same schedule every day, this reduces stress on plants as well as fish, whilst also helping to prevent algae spikes. You should avoid turning lights on or off abruptly or extending photo periods for like aesthetic reasons, as that can sort of help or promote algae to grow. It's best if you can sort of like do a ramp down. It's especially good for fish. And yeah, just don't have random lighting periods. So tank depth and placement is obviously key. Light distribution isn't equal across your tank. Deeper tanks need stronger lights or perhaps narrower beam angles. And remember, floating plants could block up, you know, potentially 50% of the light if you let them grow. And your substrate, especially if it's light, if you're using sand, is going to reflect more light than dark substrates. So that's just something to consider. You should also consider adjusting your light, height, or intensity based on plant placement or the size of the tank that you have. So you should place highlight plants at the back where the substrate's usually raised and therefore closer to the light, and shade tolerant plants lower down to the bottom of the aquarium. So next comes balancing light with CO2 and nutrients. And increasing light without enough CO2 and without enough nutrients is a fairly common mistake. So the plants will grow faster, but any algae could take advantage of that imbalance. So light, CO2 and nutrients form a triangle. And if one is missing or too low, then it has a knock-on effect and the whole kind of system can suffer. So medium to high light setups usually need CO2 injection and regular fertilization, whereas low light tanks can generally often thrive without CO2 injection, but you might need to still add a little bit of fertilizer. So again, it's just balancing out the triangle. So some common mistakes or like myths that you might sort of fall into, some traps when you first start in, is that more light will equal faster growth. And that's kind of true, but only if the nutrients and the CO2 match. And another big mistake is getting a fancy RGB light that you can really change the settings on to make things look pretty, and basically completely knocking off the spectrum. So let's just say you wanted your plants to look really, really red. So you lower the blues, you lower the greens. And as we've discussed, blues are very important for plants in terms of photosynthesis. And you just really boost up the reds because it's making everything look red and popping. But actually what you're doing is really reducing the plant's ability to photosynthesize optimally, because it's not getting the sort of color spectrum that it needs. If we think about it in nature, the sun doesn't really change its spectrum, as far as I know, maybe it does. But it's quite generally consistent for plants. So obviously if you have a light where you can sort of play around with the RGB controls of it, maybe just do it sort of like cautiously and not so crazy that you're just doing it for your aesthetics, because what we think looks good isn't necessarily what the plant thinks is good. So that's probably like a key thing to bear in mind, and it's a mistake and a trap that I've fallen into before. And another thing is not adjusting the intensity as the plants grow. So high, sort of like fast growing plants can shade lower ones. And obviously as your plants sort of like bush out, that light is getting more and more blocked the lower down. So you start getting quite leggy stems. So yeah, as your tank matures, generally they can take more light in. So obviously just take it up to the point where you're not getting algae, but everything's looking really, really good. And again, it's just all about balancing out the triangle. And just not pushing things to the extreme so much. So just always observe your plants and adjust as needed. Growth patterns will tell you if your light is too strong or too weak, and you can obviously make adjustments as you need. So just to sort of summarize and just a quick run through. So your intensity is measuring the PAR to make sure that it matches the plant's needs. Full spectrum light keeps plants healthy and vibrant. 6 to 8 hours of consistent lighting is probably optimal for most tanks. Consider your tank depths, floating plants, substrate, where you're going to place the plants, etc. Light, CO2 and nutrients must all work together, and one can't be lacking, or so it might have a knock-on effect on the other thing and therefore promote algae. So understanding these factors will help you create a thriving and beautiful aquascape, hopefully with minimal algae problems and minimal sort of plant growth problems. So I really hope this helped you. I know it's a little bit of a nerdy deep dive and it's a bit more sort of like scientific, which might not be fun to some people, but for me, I really like to try and learn the ins and outs of everything and understand how things work. But ultimately, don't get too caught up in all the crazy numbers and like PAR and all that stuff, because for the most part, for your everyday tank, you'll probably be absolutely fine with a decent light, good substrate, good fertilizer. You'll probably have a really, really healthy tank. I imagine it's perhaps more the people who go into sort of like the competitions and stuff that might worry about this, or people who are just sort of like plant nerds and want to get sort of like the best growth out of a plant that they can, which massive respect to you. I hope that hasn't sort of like put you off, because it's certainly not designed to. But yeah, thank you so much for watching. And if you liked these sort of nerdy deep dives, then let me know and I will try and do some more on all things aquascaping. Take care and I will see you in the next one.